It is 7:55, and I would like to call the City of Twinsburg regular council meeting to order. Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Scafidi?
Here.
Mr. Sorese?
Here.
Mr. Roden?
Here.
Mr. Fury?
Here.
Mr. Steele?
Here.
Ms. McFerrin?
Here.
Mrs. Stoffer?
Here.
Great. Next, we will have the invocation and pledge led by Mrs. Stoffer. Please rise.
We ask for your guidance and direction in all city matters before us tonight. We give thanks to be able to be together. Let us continue to strive to make our community a better place. Help us work together, and may we give our best always. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Next, we have the approval of the minutes from the August 23rd council meeting. Anybody have any questions or changes or corrections? Okay, hearing none, those minutes stand approved as written. Next, we have audience participation.
First, we have Sheila Williams.
Good evening, everyone. I have several things. I'm going to start as a resident, then I'm going to go to the city business. I want to tell Derek, I love all the paintings on the electrical boxes. Every time I drive past and see a new one, it's like, oh, and I really like that. And I want to thank the police department for handling situations. We've had one this recently, and they do a stellar job. I am going to ask if they will come down 91. Pass me to Lisa Lane, you know, on the other side. Several residents, we back up to 91, and there's been some concerns about traffic, walking foot traffic, and there are openings back there. And I don't know if our officers go down to Lisa and turn around and come back into Twinsburg, or if they turn at Meadowbrook. So I want to make that request. And I also want to say that as we're moving forward, the city looks fabulous, and so many good things are going on around here, and people are talking about us. I'm out and about, which I'm going to swing into what we're doing. We have a new dean at Kent State, Geauga. I don't know if you all are aware of that. Jared Tudor took a job with the University of Akron, has a regional campus down in Oroville, Ohio, down towards Columbus. So he took a job down there. He was the replacement for Dean Moen. And all that Moen has done, Jared just kind of kept it going. We have a new woman, and I brought the paper. Her name is Susan Stocker. She is the regional dean for Ashtabula. So she's now going to be splitting her time between Geauga, Twinsburg, and Ashtabula. And it's a very interesting story. We had a chance to meet her the other day. She started off as a lab technician in Thompson, Ohio. She married a dairy farmer from there, and they moved to Ashtabula, and she took classes at Ashtabula College and got her undergrad and went on to get a nursing degree and yada, yada, yada. And here now she's running the Ashtabula campus, which I find very fascinating because she can really talk to students about if you persevere, what you can become. We're not sure how this merging is going to be because there is a new regional vice president. I think I may have spoken about it. I may not. He came by way of Edinburgh to us. President Warren handpicked him. He's a math person, so he's crunching numbers, and they're looking at consolidating programs across all the regional campuses. You cannot run programs with five students at one campus and five students at another, so they're looking at satelliting and teachers traveling. And I think that's the biggest concern now, as Dr. Stockton talked to us last week at the meeting, teachers are a little concerned about that. Our enrollment is busting at the seams here in Twinsburg. We could really use some more space. Geauga, on the other hand, they're being sustained by the web-based internet courses. So Dr. Stockton and the new vice president are looking at what can they do out there to give them the same success as we have. And, I mean, you know, she made a comment that Lakeland used to be Ashtabula's competition at Kent State to David Moen came. And he changed all of that. And then when he built the Twinsburg facility, it took it to a whole nother level. I found it a little concerning as a Twinsburg resident and why I'm there on the board. And we're recruiting new members. We have several people that we're going to approve next month, and we'll know better about that. But I wanted to make you aware of the new president or dean that is there at the campus. And she does have an office here. I don't know what day of the week. If any of you wanted to meet her, you could call and find out. Then the Summit County Public Health, we just had a strategic planning. I have a booklet for the mayor. I'll give it to Shannon. This heroin epidemic in Summit County is unbelievable, for lack of a better word for it. And Margot, our medical director, is tearing her hair out, and there is so much outreach going on in the community trying to address this. They want to declare it a national problem, and Ohio being one of the states for state of emergency. That would provide more funding for programs and different things like that. I don't know where that's going. I don't know if any of you saw the young man and woman in the car the other day, dead with the child in the back seat, and it's just horrific. We're doing some more things with the schools now, trying to talk with the elementary school and junior high kids about it, because these kids are being exposed to this. And children have to know there's a safe place. So that was one of the things that we talked about. The budgeting of what we did is in here. If you want to talk with Donna, the director, in depth about it, we broke it down. We have two facilities. You know, we have the Graham Road one, and so we've moved the Refugee Information Center out there. That seemed to be a better location for them to be able to get there and make sure their shots and things are done, help with the transitioning back, because Akron does do a lot with refugees, and I think people would really be surprised. We're moving forward. Several positions open. There's a spreadsheet on here if any of you want to see it, from the mayor, showing environmental is a big thing. We're dealing with letting, we're dealing with wells. A funny story, which I think Chris and some of the people that work for City Hall can respect. We had a woman whose well failed. Well, when we came out, there was a huge addition on top of it. And she just couldn't understand what the problem was with this huge addition on top. And so we worked with her to help her to put in a new one at a different location, but we attached on the deed that there is still another well there that was contaminating the land. And, you know, we have some older properties. I was on the street here in Twinsburg, and I thought about it. I said, it's not even paved up here. I didn't even know it was here. I went to a garage sale. So all of the communities are dealing with letting. We've got big money from the federal government. And, again, I would encourage any of you, if you have a chance to go down to Akron, go through the facility. It's state-of-the-art. Everything's there. We're doing so much, and it's a county-wide initiative. It's not just one or two communities. This is across the county, and the money that's being used, everyone can see. So I want to turn in my report. I'll give you the name of the new dean, and you can have a chance to, you know, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me.
Thank you, Mrs. Williams.
Thanks, Sheila. Just a quick side note. I get the daily updates of overdoses. Daily overdoses from Summit County emailed to me every day, and it really is a serious issue that we have. I mean, we average 10 to 20 a day in Summit County, so we had 40 over the weekend. So just to give you some numbers so you can put it in perspective of what we're dealing with.
Yeah, and this is not, I think the realization is this is from people that were given pain pills, medication, injuries, depression, and they're not at that stable state anymore, so they've gone to another level. And it's just impacting every community in Summit County. And, you know, and I don't know how much we're involved in it here as far as the police department and things, but I'm sure that we're doing all that we can also.
Thank you very much. Shannon, next.
Next we have Bob Thews.
I Good evening again. This is Bob Thews, 2229 Demi Drive, and that's in the Meadowood community. And first of all, before I get started, kudos to the Twinsburg Police Department and what they did in that tragic event that happened not too far from us at East Idlewild. They did a wonderful job. It was well handled, and you can't ask for anything better than that. So kudos to them. They did a wonderful job. That's the good news, now the bad news. Okay. So far, it appears that the council has really not made an effort to move forward on that statement they made during the prior political season. And that statement, as quoted by almost everybody I talked to, was, let's see how the roundabout at Glenwood goes, and then we'll have another vote on the Meadowood roundabout. I've heard discussion about a survey. I haven't seen any action on it. Well, you know, we told you we already conducted a survey. It was an unbiased survey, up or down, yes or no, you want it or you don't. We had 101 votes, of which 88 voted against. That's 87%. That's 101 votes out of a voting community of about 500. So that puts it around 20% of the voting populace. As you probably remember from your quantitative analysis course in college, 20% is a statistically significant number. The results won't change, okay? It may go to maybe 85% or 90%, but there's not going to be much of a change. So any further voting, in my estimation, is just a tool to delay the vote that might reject a second roundabout. Secondly, I really want to know how this roundabout will resolve the early morning rush hour traffic heading north. Oh yeah, that light at Lisa Lane, that has traffic backed all the way down to Glenwood. That roundabout isn't going to do one iota of good on that. Okay. Thirdly, the submission that you recently made for the grant asked for supporting documentation such as accident reports, impact on school zones, photos, and a variety of other things. That block on that grant was left blank without any submission of any safety data. That the big pitch for this whole roundabout has been safety, safety, safety. So my question is, how many fatalities have we had in this intersection? None. How many accidents have we had of any kind at this intersection? We have one every 2 years, one every 3 years, one every 5 years. I can guarantee you there are more accidents in the Liberty Glenwood Circle in the first year than we've had in a year at that intersection. And if safety was an issue, then how come there was zero safety information submitted with that grant? So let's face it, in my opinion, this is as close to a political patronage program as I've seen since Boss Tweed was in business. Now, for council members who don't know who Boss Tweed is, I'll explain that after the meeting, but it's time to bring this thing really to a vote. Now, in private discussions with Councilman Roden, he has made it clear to me that he would prefer that other members of this council drive this vote. So I'm asking those whom I feel hear the voice of the people to bring this to a vote in council. So I thank you for your and would appreciate your voting on this issue.
Thank you. Shannon, next.
Michael Turrell.
Good evening, Council and Mayor. Thank you for allowing for the time for us to come here. I also would like to thank our wonderful safety forces, along with Summit County and Boston Heights. Who else do we have? Macedonia, Solon, Hudson,
Sheriff's Office.
Did a great job with our situation last week. I went by to check my parents. It was literally right in their backyard in an area that I grew up playing in as a kid. It was a little bit surreal, but the situation was handled as well as everybody could have hoped for, and all of our good guys got to go home. I'm here to speak tonight about this Twinsburg Tree Program. I think I came in and proposed it once here, and I stopped in at the Parks and Rec Commission meeting and trying to find the right proper avenue. I was invited to an Environmental Commission meeting, and I was able to present the idea in a little bit more detail there because it's a little bit, you know, a little bit more laid back, and I had a little bit more time to go through. But they seem very excited with the idea. Excuse me. Miss Daisy is told me that she's going to follow through with Amy and Mr. Stanley Stein and get their input on the idea before they bring this whole idea into council to present. But I did take a few minutes to type up basically my whole idea of this thing in detail. I'm not going to go through and read this all right now, but I did print up 8 copies that I can pass out to you guys, and you guys can read it at your leisure. My phone number's on here if you guys have any question. I know I did speak with Mr. Scafidi with this, I think 3 years ago. I mentioned it to you about it, and he seemed to like the idea then. Of course, that was before I made him walk all of Ward 1 last summer, but that was a joke. Okay, that's all. We can laugh a little bit about that. But anyhow, I just wanted to say thank you to the Environmental Commission, and I'll bring this up and pass this out to you guys. You can read it, and this is a little brief preview of what the Environmental Commission is going to be bringing to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Turrell. I thought maybe you were coming up to tell us how much you appreciate your brand new street and all that stuff. But I haven't heard that yet. I haven't heard that one time. Not once. Brand new streets.
You still got time left.
Mm-hmm.
Just give it a move past it.
Goes right up to your driveway. Thanks for the kudos. We appreciate that.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Put a picture of that on Facebook, will you? Please. Thank you. It's gone. Brand new. All right, we'll move on. Shannon, anybody else?
There is none.
There is none? Thank you. Okay, we will move on to the, where are we at here? Awards and presentations. We have none. Council communication and committee reports. How about we start with Mrs. Stauffer?
I have not had any meetings. BZA meets tomorrow here in council chambers at 6 o'clock, I believe it's 6 o'clock. And that's it.
Okay, thank you. Mr.
Soracy. The Twins Days Committee is already planning for 2017 festival, and they began meeting already. Public Works met this evening, and Mr. Scafidi, as the chair, will report on that in a little bit. Community Relations Board will meet next week on Thursday, 9/22. At 5:30 p.m. here at City Hall. And that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Roden.
Thank you. So the Environmental Commission met this past Thursday. I'm going to show a couple of things. I don't know how well you'll see it, but back by popular demand, we have the shredding, scheduled another shredding event and extended the time from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. on Saturday, September 24th. This is for Twinsburg and Twinsburg Township residents. The limit is 10 boxes or bags per car. No newspapers, DVDs, magazines, or binders. All shredded paper will be recycled, and the entrance will be at the Public Works facility. And thank you to the Public Works people for all that you do, and for the Environmental Commission for being there and helping navigate traffic. I know last time it was out all the way onto the street. So we're hoping it'll be just as popular this time. It is September 24th, and it's from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m.
Thank you.
In conjunction with the free document shredding event, the Environmental Commission and Public Works will host a household hazardous waste on Saturday, September 24th as well, and this will be the same time from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Twinsburg Public Works on Ravenna Road. So please go to the website to note what is accepted and what's not accepted materials. But this also is a big popular event that we've had before, so we're happy that we're doing it again. And again, we thank the Public Works Commission for all that they do. The Environmental Commission is looking for volunteers for this event. High school students volunteering will be working with the document event and will receive community hours. And we also need volunteers as adults as well for the household hazardous waste. You can call City Hall if you're interested in volunteering. And then we also discussed that we will be looking for more. We've always in the past had like 11th graders, 12th graders who have been on the commission, and we're actually, and it's a teen position, so we actually are looking to go a little younger and get more involvement from someone maybe in the 9th or 10th graders. So we're looking to hopefully get some more involvement and have them stay on a little bit longer so they can continuously go through school and do that. One other thing we're looking at, which kind of goes on with what Mr. Turrell talked about, is Tree City USA. I know that we've been in contact with Amy Moore and asking if that's something we want to go back into. I know we were in this program before, and I know there's some interest in possibly doing that again. So we had a great meeting. I think the team does a great job, and we are going to be very busy this fall. So thank you very much. And then you're going to talk about Public Works. That's it.
Thank you. Mr. Fury.
Thank you and good evening. The Planning Commission met on September 12th last evening to discuss the approval of a conditional use for a helistop for the University Hospital location adjacent to 480. They had already had approval for a heliport previously, but had not constructed it and were using the field to the left of the property as a temporary station. When they did that, no matter what time of year, Twinsburg Fire would have to get the patient and transport them from the building the 100 yards to the helicopter. So what they're doing instead, and what was approved last night, 4-1, was a heliport that will be behind the building so that they can enter it and leave right off of 480. It'll be a very short movement from the building right out the back. And the following conditions were attached, that the way this is not going to be nearly as busy as the Cleveland Clinic, in that they average between 12 and 15 flights a year. It's not the 3 or 4 a day. So the lights will be turned on from the helicopter. As it gets close, it will turn on the landing lights. They won't be on all the time. At the same time, there is a request that we have a lit sign that alerts the traffic on 480 so that they're not startled of what's going on when those lights pop on and somebody's coming down low. They also are going for an approval, Mrs. Stauffer's BZA meeting tomorrow night for a setback that they need for that because it's fairly close to the building. And they've also got to continue to land bank that area that they were using temporarily in case they need the additional 46 parking spots. And the city would have control whether we tell them they need to build a parking lot or not. There's also a potential variance that will come up later that council will handle regarding a small fence to allow them not to put a small fence around the heliport. And the reason they'd rather not have the fence around the heliport is they want to be able to do snow removal very quickly. This will be a flat area and the lights will be inset in the concrete. So, but the next meeting for the Planning Commission will be on September 26th, and at this time there is not anything on the agenda. So if they do not fill that, the meeting will be canceled. And that's all I have at this point. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. McFerrin.
So Parks and Rec, I know Derek will do a really good job presenting updates, but I did hear that the Doggy Swim was excellent, well attended, and everyone looks forward to it next year. The court flooring and the fitness center has been completed. The indoor pool has been up and running, and I do have to say that the food at the pool concession stands are really good this year. And I've heard other people comment on it, so good job and good kudos. The chamber, there was a 3-chamber event last Wednesday. David Joyce, our congressman, spoke. And then there's the upcoming fall clam bake and festival on October 6th. And I have nothing else to report.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Steele.
ARB, the Architectural Review Board, met on the 1st, and they had a really light agenda. They approved one house and 2 signs, and the ARB is going to meet this Thursday. So that's it.
That's it. Okay, thank you. My report. Good evening. The Finance Committee meeting has not met. However, we do have a meeting scheduled for October 11th at 5:30 here in the City Hall. Capital Improvements Board, again, has not met, but our first meeting with them will be on September 29th at 7 o'clock here at City Hall as well. Public Works Committee did meet tonight, and we discussed with the engineer the 2017 road program, and most of council was here, and everybody kind of gave their opinions and thoughts about what the program should be, and she laid out to us what the tentative plan that she had for the road program. So I think we, you know, in some of the council opinion, that we need to make some tweaks to that program, and we're going to see where we can do that and still maintain the current budget. So I don't know, we talked about having another meeting, but that may not be necessary, but we'll see where it goes. But we are planning that 2017 road program. Compensation Committee has not met. Oh, the next meeting of this Twinsburg CIC will be next Tuesday, September 20th at 5:30 at the meeting area in this by the square. Other than that, I think that's all I have under my report. So I will stop talking. Next, we have the mayor's report. Mayor.
Thanks. Good evening, everyone. Just to report on a couple of things around town. Cornerstone has been still very busy. We have a new business that's opened up there, National DCP, which is a distribution company for Dunkin' Donuts. So we have a lot of Dunkin' Donuts activity going on in the city. Is if you've driven down 82, you've noticed that the retail store is getting very close to opening. I think in the next 3 or 4 weeks that'll be opening. But again, we're just all thrilled with all the everything that's going on at Cornerstone. They continue to send us emails that they're entertaining different businesses that want to build there and be part of that industrial park. So we hope that they continue to fill up all the space that they can there. Route 91 project is continuing to move along. Thank you for your patience. I think they've done a pretty good job keeping traffic flowing there. We have both sides of Glenwood shut down at this time. Expected to open up next week. So we're still shooting for a November, you know, to have the final completion of that in November. A couple things going on. Mr. Roden did mention the Environmental Commission has a shredding event and a hazardous material event, so it's free to residents. Just a little bit of logistics. I believe all the cars are going to be coming in on that main drive, coming into wastewater, where they'll be checking for residency there. And then those can basically dump off any hazardous waste materials and then move on to the shredding. So we're trying to set that up to where it's as smooth as possible if you're coming to do both. I believe, and Chris may report on this, but branch shipping is going on in the city. So getting ready to start or has already started. So get your branches out if you need to. Things going on in the fitness center, Darren may report on. So the new floor is in. It looks great. I've got a lot of good compliments on the new floor. Pretty much came in on schedule. But a lot of different things going on. So you're going to notice some activity around the old Witch site. So we've got some legislation that's pending tonight that would allow the city to operate a cafe there. So I guess keep your eyes open. I've got a lot of questions about what's going to happen there, what's going to go on. So that's what we're planning. Hopefully it'll be successful. Karen may speak about this, but we've had a pretty aggressive schedule with the 17 budget, and we're getting close to getting the budget out to Capital Improvement Board. We're going to have some budget hearings scheduled here soon, continuing to move at a faster pace with our budget for 17 so that we can really have an idea of what's going to be going on next year. So I would encourage, I know Mr. Ceresi mentioned this, but as we schedule that for all of council to try to participate and be part of those budget hearings, I agree. I think in the past we've kind of gone through capital improvement and then the finance and then to council, and our department heads have seemed to kind of do three presentations. So I'd encourage you, if you can, try to make make those budget hearings when we schedule them. And then lastly, I just want to commend our city as a whole for the incident that happened on Sunday before Labor Day. Our safety forces, I think we have a true appreciation of what they do and how they safeguard our community with that event. It was a very tense situation. I spent time between kind of a command center that was near the Dino Palmieri's parking lot, and I don't know if a lot of residents or even council knows, we evacuated a number of residents to the community center. So I also want to thank Derek and Brandon and Jen and everybody that came in to open up that facility at 9 o'clock at night to get residents a place to safely stay until to where we were to get them back. But another group is our CERT team. They mobilized about 15 people on a Sunday night before a holiday to help residents, these are volunteers, and to coordinate and transport residents from a safe spot on East Ottawood up to our community center. So I just want to thank everyone that was involved. The residents I spoke with were extremely thankful, and I guess a little bit also to the Hilton Garden Inn. I spoke with them and said, look, we may be sending people there to spend the night. We have a condo situation, and I don't know, we want to put the adjacent people back into their homes. And they were great. They worked with us. And so some residents got a night out at a hotel, but wasn't expected, but they did help out. So I think the city as a whole did a great job handling that event. I was impressed to see all the coordination from the different communities that happened with our safety forces, as well as other departments that stepped up. You kind of forget about those behind the scenes, but to see three people show up from Parks and Rec on a Sunday night to make sure everyone was taken care of says a lot about our community and who we have working here. So, and that's all I have.
Just 1 second. Mr. Ceresi got a text from someone.
Just in case anybody gets up to leave, I just got a text that someone who left said there's a skunk in the flower beds right outside the door. And I know sometimes people get up and leave while we're conducting business, so you're on your own.
You don't want to get skunked.
That's all.
Okay, thanks.
And don't prop the door
all right,
open.
Department heads.
All right, department heads. All right, so Chris, you want to start?
I'd like to thank the service department for placing the skunk in the flower bed. Since the last council meeting, we have made some asphalt repairs on Stanley Lane as a result of a Cleveland Water dig. And as I told you before, we were going to take over the landscaping restorations. We currently do not have any locations to do, so that's good, but when they do come in, we get notifications from Cleveland Water and we will handle those. Street sweeping, we have completed our second round, and we collected 28.5 cubic yards, which is a big number. It's, you wouldn't remember what the numbers are, but the street sweeper, it's a brand new unit and it's doing a real good job. So that's going real well. So that is out there, and we're going to start that third round probably in the next week or two. Branch chipping, as the mayor mentioned, we are out there doing the September round, and we're going to be finishing that in the next couple of days. But in July, we had that storm around mid-month, and we put together a special round. And that one took us 9 days. It was big. 773 homes is what we got to with those branches. For the month of August, by comparison, we picked up branches at 300 homes. So it was a pretty significant storm and left us with a fair amount of damage. So they got all that picked up, and the next round will be on Monday, October 3rd. And I think we've discussed before, we're probably going to extend that program into November, see how that goes. Related to that, storm area checks, they did, because of all the storms coming through, they checked the system on three additional
occasions. And so they're keeping that system pretty free of debris. We've had no problems with any significant backups in those areas that they check. Couple of the new programs, sidewalk leveling. You know, we went through a learning curve on that, and but with that, we've already gotten to 59 locations with sidewalk leveling. So I think that's pretty good. Again, this was our first year. We're going through, you know, a learning curve. Still, we really don't know. I think it's more a matter of how much time we have to commit to that program from now on. I think we've got it down pat. Guys are doing a real good job with it. So we'll stay with it and then, you know, see what time we commit to that program. The hydrant painting, we're basically halfway done with the whole city, which is just amazing. We've got 621 hydrants totally painted. We've got a bunch more that are prepared. We have used the plug hog on there, and they're ready for paint. So we're going to easily do 700 or 800 hydrants. So if we have luck with the paint, which we've gone to a much more durable paint, we're hoping to get, you know, 5+ years out of that. So I think overall our hydrants are going to look good for many years. And then when we get to the point of painting those, it's going to be a much more manageable program with the way we're doing it. So that's pretty good results on that. So between, you know, those two programs, I think we're making pretty good headway with some of our infrastructure. Related to that, I had the guys go out and inventory all the fiberglass light bulbs, the black fiberglass thing that we've had our share of issues with, because that fiberglass, you've got to keep it coated with paint. We have a count of 1,149 poles, and we figure at this point, we went out in 2007, 2010, and 2012 and painted poles. We now have about 650 of those poles that need painted. The majority of those were not painted during that previous program. The paint that we have seems to be, it's like a gel paint, and it seems to be holding up pretty well. So next year, we'd like to target those, and we probably will be able to get those done. It's a program that Ohio Edison used to run, but because of their budget cuts, they'll provide us with the paint, but they don't provide that service. So we're going to make sure that the minute they start doing that we'll put a request in for that. Wanted to let you know, Warren Parkway, we've sprayed those lawns a couple times with the weed killer, and towards the end of this growing season, they've already overseeded once. We're going to overseed it again. So I think we'll get good results out of that area. I think we should be in good shape. So we're continuing on with that. And you probably noticed out the side door here, the ADA ramp project has begun. They're estimating a 12 to 14 week construction period, mostly because the handrails are somewhat custom. So you'll probably see the ramp go in, and then there will be, you know, depending on how quick they can get that, those handrails.
Yeah, it's a long time.
Yeah, well, I think most of it is the handrail, and they're working on trying to get that a little bit sooner.
It's the ordering time on the handrail.
And so the last thing I wanted to mention on the household hazardous and shredding, it's kind of a combined effort. The CERT team, the service department, the Environmental Commission, and then Clean Harbors is the company, actually, with the chemists and everybody needed on site to process all of that material. So it's a big effort, and I appreciate the help of all these groups of people that will be there with us. And I think that's all I have.
Chris, I hope you are picking up sticks in November and not snow.
No, I got to get rid of some salt. I'm actually hoping for a little bit of snow.
Chris, did you talk about you talked about the auction, right? It's coming. What's
yes.
the date? How do residents get to that?
Well, the auction is online.
It's online, so
yeah.
Do you know?
And it's govdeals.com.
GovDeals, okay.
Yeah.
And when does that start?
We're pretty much recently we've had items on there continually.
Okay.
And this is a lot of different government agencies that,
okay.
So there's always things on there.
Right.
So I mean we've had
So these items will go on, the ones you just
okay. Yeah, the items that we have approved we'll put on probably in the next week.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks, Chris.
If it's approved.
And just to make an announcement about the hazardous waste, we will not be accepting latex paint. So that's a huge, issue. Latex paint, you can throw cat litter in it and put it in your normal trash. So we're encouraging, we're paying for this for whatever happens with Clean Harbors and whatever they collect. We pay to have all this processed, and there's no reason for us to pay for, and this is not uncommon. I mean, this is pretty much across the board on hazardous waste dumps like this, that latex paint is not provided. So I want to make sure the residents understand that, because I'm sure there's going to be a lot of people grabbing all those latex paint cans and bringing them, and we're going to send them back home with them. So with hopefully some suggestions. We did have a meeting, and we may have a little printout on what to do with that paint. So just let them know. And then another thing, just want to let the council know, in case you have any contact, we have about, it was about 40 private fire hydrants in the city. And with the, minutes, we can strip and spray a primer on these. And we've made a decision. We were getting some requests with some of the private owners of the private to basically strip and paint those. So I had Chris send out a letter to all of them. There was just a couple that requested it, but I said, send it out to all of them. Let them know that it's available. So the ones that are responding saying, yes, come onto our property and strip and paint. And I just thought, you know, I'm sure we monitor those, but I would much rather make sure we're keeping those up to date for the fire department. And as quick as we're able to do those now, it's, you know, within a couple hours, we can go through those. So
we
just want to let council know.
We would have private fire hydrant.
Dearon Apartments could be one example. Those kind of facilities. Yeah, private streets, condos, those. All right, Chief Noga.
Good evening. During the month of August, the City of Twinsburg Communication Center generated 2,354 calls for service among the Twinsburg Police and Fire Departments and the Reminderville Police and Fire Departments. The total call count for the year is 17,261. Twinsburg police officers arrested and are cited 111 suspects into court on 168 different counts. Officers issued 158 written warnings in 7 parking sites. Officers investigated 44 traffic crashes, of which 5 were injury crashes, 11 were on private property, and none were fatal. Just a couple of things. One, our canine Yasso is not only now a national sensation, but an international sensation. If you've caught anything in your social media feeds of him getting his puppuccino at Starbucks when he was off duty, it is spread. I've seen it on Fox News. I've got a message from a friend of mine who lives in Germany. It was featured there. So we have an international star in our ranks now. So if you haven't seen it, Twinsburg Canine, Google it, and it's a really cute video. Secondly, as part of our traffic safety program, we had talked a while back about speed signs, the electronic speed signs, and we had tested a couple over the years. We have purchased 2 this year. We finished programming them. We are working with the service department. Right now, we made a list of locations where we get the most complaints about speeding. We're going to have USIC come out, mark those locations to make sure when they go in the ground, they're not going to damage any utility lines. It's basically going to go on a post, and it's a box, and it's not like the traffic trailer of old where we had to hook it up and drag it out there all the time. So we'll be able to move them around pretty quickly. It has a readout, so if you're set to a level, you know, if you're 10 miles over, it'll start flashing. So we have 2 that in our possession now. Hopefully within the next couple weeks, we'll start seeing those in selected locations. I have 2 that I'm putting in the budget for 2017. We'll also be able to draw a lot of data from those signs as well. We'll be able to do traffic counts and figure out just exactly what kind of speeding problems an area may have. So my hope is to add a couple more, and then at some point having something for active maybe in every ward at any given time, so that we can really use that as part of our traffic safety program. So as soon as they're up, I will let you know, and you come take a look at them, drive past them. Try not to set them off. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Chief Morgan?
Good evening. Just to bring you up to date, since we weren't here for a meeting at the beginning of last month, we had 213 calls for service in July. And then in August, we've had 256 calls for service. That's the highest number of calls in a month we've had in the history of the department. The previous record was back in December of 14. And just to highlight, for instance, on August 10th, between noon and midnight, a 12-hour period, we ran 22 calls. Some of that was storm-related, but it also included legitimate rescue calls, a mutual aid call to Streetsboro for a fire. It's just the nature of emergencies, and you just never know when they're coming. Through the month of September, we went to mutual aid fire calls in Streetsboro and in Macedonia, and we also had a significant motorcycle accident on I-480 back on the 19th that required both riders to be taken to Life Flight aeromedical evacuation to trauma centers. I understand that both of them are recovering. And just again, a sample of what goes on. On the 21st, we ended up on I-480 doing some tree trimming. Late on a Sunday evening, a tree fell out on I-480, and it was in a bad spot with bad sight lines, and the police department had multiple units out there directing traffic around it, and we were able to go out and cut the tree, get it off the side of the road, and free up the police department because, it's a Sunday afternoon. It took ODOT cleaned it up ultimately, but it took them a while to get there. So, a little bit of everything. For fire prevention, we completed 132 inspections in the month of August. We also did three different fire investigations during the month of August. We had 13 public education events that impacted over 200 people. And we had over 61 different training events with 371 hours of training for our personnel. Points of interest, weather warning sirens. We did the test on September 3rd, and all of the sirens worked properly except the one near Liberty and Cannon Road. That was referred to service department. They went and checked it. The batteries were bad, and we suspect that there was also an issue with the charging system on that unit, and that's being monitored. We've accomplished several hirings over the past couple of months of part-time personnel. Well, we've hired three part-time personnel. Unfortunately, we also received the resignation of a part-time person who gained full-time employment with another department. Coming up, we have a couple special events I want to make you aware of. On this Friday, up at Station 2, we'll be hosting for the second year University Hospital's Aeromedical Services training event. So all three of their helicopters will be landing up at Station 2 on the ground behind the station, and they'll be going through some training for general EMS issues and also special emergency operations with the helicopters and things of that nature. We hosted it last year. It turned out well, and they chose to come back again. And we also want to bring to everyone's attention in October 12th, our annual Fire Prevention Week open house. We want to make sure everyone's aware of that, put it on your calendars, and plan to join us that evening. Two other items I just want to bring to your attention. Again, in the absence during recess, we received an award of a grant for almost $24,000 in training equipment from the Firehouse Subs Public Safety Foundation. One of our firefighters submitted the application, and it was selected, and we now have that new equipment, and you'll see it displayed at Open House if you come. And we also received word in the last couple of weeks that we've been awarded an $80,000 grant from FEMA to install an exhaust evacuation system at Station 1, a direct capture system. It's at about an $80,000 project. The feds will pay $70,000-some, we'll pay 10%. So I'll be coming forward with legislation for appropriations and request for you to accept that, hopefully at the next meeting, if I get it all pulled together. I think that's all for my report.
Thanks, Chief.
Thank you.
Thank you. You reporting, Derek? Come on up.
We talked about a few things already, so the bicentennial, the water park fence is going up. It's almost complete, just in time for it to close on Saturday of last week for the dog swim, but it did turn out to be nice. Probably one of our best days of dog weather we've had. It's usually always rainy and cold, so that was a good weather for us. I do want to announce Twinsburg Community Theater. We have auditions coming for The Little Mermaid, which will be in the end of October. All that will be going through the schools coming up here shortly. Ms. McBaron mentioned the TFC floor is complete, looks great. You can hear squeaky shoes now. It's really grippy, which is great. The outdoor pool closed, the indoor pool reopened after we had a good chance to drain it and clean it all and get the pool up and running. A couple of events coming up. We help participate in the Twinsburg Chamber Clam Bake on October 6th. It's actually moving locations from the square up to Glen Chamberlain Park, kind of go tailgate feel in conjunction with a home football game. So it was on the 7th, but then the football game is going to be televised, something, so it got moved to the 6th. So now it's on October 6th to coincide with the football game. Our arts festival, which is typically in the spring, is going to be in the fall on October 22nd. Truck or Treat is on October 30th at the Fitness Center. And then in early November or mid-November, November 12th, is our Turkey Trot 5-miler race, and we're actually going to add on a kids' fun run in association with that to this year. So we're going to have a couple things in Luminosity. So you'll see some stuff coming out, PR, about all those events here, and we need volunteers for a lot of those things, so we'll be reaching out to the schools for those too. But it's, you know, it's a busy season. I do want to support Chris's legislation for the Air Force One. It is very cold in that back hallway when we have to walk through. And I only have to walk through once or twice a day. So that's it.
Thanks, Jerry.
Thank you.
Well, she got me.
Larry, I see you here. I wasn't sure if you were reporting. You reporting?
I can if you like.
Sure, come on up. It's been 3 weeks.
Sorry.
Just a couple of things. working with the finance director, we're trying to work with FedEx to get information on contractors who work for the company but don't necessarily pay taxes, income taxes to the city. So we've gotten in touch with them. We're going to work with them to get a list of contractors. Then we have to address tax payments with the contractors themselves. So that'll be an ongoing effort. you see the ramp is well underway. That was funded in part by Summit County Community Development Block Grant. That Summit County Community Block Grant is coming around again for the 2017 program. The application period is in October. It funds a number of different kinds of things, and as long as there's a low moderate benefit, a contribution to the elimination of slums or blighting influences, any project that addresses any of those issues can be addressed. Typically with the county, their grant amounts are around 25 to 30 to 50,000 max. You know, if there's something you feel might be eligible and you have an idea, give me a buzz. I'd certainly love to talk to you about it. We may or may not be able to apply because we have to have our project done that we're working on before we're able to get awarded for another project. I also wanted to request a work session with council sometime in the near future to talk about downtown redevelopment districts. It's a new program that was authorized by the state legislature in House Bill 233. This particular program allows for tax increment financing, a method of tax increment financing where property taxes are deferred to pay for infrastructure improvements in redevelopment areas. The redevelopment area can be no larger than 10 acres in size. It has to have a historic component, and it can involve a technology aspect where if there's internet service available at 1 gigabyte, I think, or higher, you can also incorporate that into the project. So that's something I'd like to talk to you a little bit more about, and just give you a brief presentation on what it could mean and a couple of the potential areas that could be addressed by this kind of program around the square. The Independence Parkway extension is moving along. That was funded in part by two grants that we acquired from the state of Ohio, the Development Service Agency, and from the Ohio Department of Transportation. We're working now to set up a reimbursement system with the developer, and that will process about $487,000 worth of grant money that will contribute to the $800,000 price tag of the extension. There's another loan opportunity coming up that we may want to consider. The Ohio Development Service Agency and the Ohio Water Development Authority have a brownfield cleanup loan program. It's a very attractive program from a loan perspective. The loan rates are tied to the Treasury rate, which right now are around 2.5%. The loan period can be up to 30 years. And it will finance basically the mitigation of environmental hazards in public buildings like the old school, for instance. So it could be something. It could be a tool we could utilize to, if we wish to move forward with the old school and dealing with the asbestos mitigation there. It's a loan, obviously. It's not a grant. The federal US EPA Brownfield Cleanup Program will be coming out in November with their application process. That's a grant for asbestos mitigation or demolition. That's something else we might want to have a further discussion on.
Already applied for a grant for asbestos removal?
We made application to the US EPA Cleanup Program last year. We were not funded.
Thank you.
They had 800 applicants. They were only funding 230. Unfortunately, we didn't rank high enough, primarily because this is a relatively small project compared to this is a national competition. But I think it would behoove us to try again. There's no guarantee with that program, however. The next CIC meeting, as was mentioned earlier, is scheduled for the 20th on Tuesday. And it was also mentioned the UH Helistop will be in front of the BZA tomorrow. The unique issue with this is that it'll have to come back to planning to council for its final site plan approval, because there's a requirement in the our codified ordinances require a perimeter fence around the landing area. Because of the confined nature of this landing area, and because of the hospital's desire to be able to clean the particular area in inclement weather. They don't wish to have a fence there. They can restrict traffic to and from the area very easily because it's in back and it's a very, kind of out of the way place. So that'll be one of the things that we'll be coming back to council for as part of the conditional use approval, recognizing the fact that it also will be a variance granted by council to eliminate the requirement for a perimeter fence. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Larry.
Karen?
Mayor, thank you for giving my report. I have nothing to... We did have our first advance. We're 53% up. that equates to about $470,000 more than last year, but that is the first advance. We should be getting our final distribution coming shortly, so I'll give a full report once we receive it for our income tax for the month of September. I just wanted to let you give you an update status regarding our CDS, which is a continued disclosure statement. We're continuing to work on that. Thank you, Larry, for submitting a report and update on economic development as it relates to 2015 and forthcoming for the future. And again, our audit report has been submitted and finalized to the auditor of state, and then we have to wait for approval before release to the public. And lastly, I'll just briefly mention again that kind of echo what the mayor said. The budget has been finalized, and it definitely, I would say, the department heads, with the mayor's guidance, have done some due diligence ensuring that we continue to operate a very efficient and very few increases have occurred. So you'll be receiving that report sometime shortly. There's just a few little modifications that we're working on before we finalize, and you'll have ample time to review it before the budget hearings begin. And that's all I have to report.
Thank you. And that's all I have this evening.
That's it. Thank you. Okay, we will now move on to the legislation portion of our meeting. Shannon, we have Ordinance 812016.
An ordinance amending the current year appropriations for the various general and special revenue accounts as established in Ordinance 6, 2016, the appropriation ordinance of the City of Twinsburg for the year 2016.
Okay, and that's its second reading tonight. Next, we have Ordinance 85-2016.
An ordinance requesting the fiscal officer of Summit County, Ohio, to accept certification of delinquent sanitary sewer rentals and water fund maintenance charges as compiled and placed on record in the office of the Twinsburg Finance Director and declaring an emergency.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion that we place Ordinance 85-2016 on its third and final reading and declare it an emergency. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, there's a second. Is there any discussion on that? The reason we need this is certifying the delinquent sewer and water maintenance charges down to the county, and there's a deadline to do that. So that's why we need the emergency tonight. You have a second? Any other discussion? Shannon, call the roll.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Rudin?
Yes.
Now we need a motion to adopt Ordinance 85-2016 as an emergency. Can I have a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Mr. Steele. Second.
Second.
Mrs. Stauffer seconds. Mm-hmm. Any discussion? Shannon.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Okay, Ordinance 85-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Next, we have Ordinance 86-2016.
An ordinance authorizing the sale at auction of certain personal property owned by the City of Twinsburg and no longer needed for municipal purposes and declaring an emergency.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion that we suspend the rules on Ordinance 86-2016, place it on its third and final reading, and declare it an emergency. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Cerisi seconds. Any discussion on that? This is the sale of items, city items that we do every year, and council approves the list that's going out, and these items will then be placed on govdeals.com. So in order to sell these items in a timely manner, we do need the emergency tonight. That's it. Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Okay, now I need a motion to adopt Ordinance 86-2016 as an emergency. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Mr. Roden, second.
I'll second.
Mrs. Stauffer, any discussion? Okay, Shannon?
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes. Ordinance 86-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Next, we have Ordinance 87-2016.
An ordinance authorizing the purchase of one leaf collection unit through American Road Machine for use by the service department and declaring an emergency.
Okay, I want to make a motion that we suspend the rules on Ordinance 87-2016, place it on its third and final reading, and declare it an emergency. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Cerisi, second. Any discussion? This is a leaf collection unit that they're going to be purchasing to replace an old unit in the service department. I'm assuming we need an emergency to put that into effect this year for our leaf collection season, correct? Okay. Shannon, call a roll, please.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Great. Now I need a motion to adopt Ordinance 87-2016 as an emergency. Mr. Steele, is there a second?
I'll second. Yeah, I yield.
Mr. Roden? Okay, I have a second. Any discussion?
The unit costs $60,000, and we're going to do auction or sell the existing unit.
Amen. Shannon, call the roll.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes. Ordinance 87-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Next, we have Resolution 88-2016.
A resolution authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement with Air Force One for the HVAC system control upgrade and declaring an emergency.
I want to make a motion that we adopt Resolution 88-2016 as an emergency. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, we have adoption and a second. This is to upgrade the HVAC system, control system in the City Hall. We need an emergency on this, of course, to complete it for the 2016 season, and the cost of this is $44,000. Any other questions or discussion? Shannon, call the roll.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Okay, Resolution 88-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Resolution 89-2016.
A resolution authorizing the mayor to enter into a supply agreement with Interstate Gas Supply Incorporated to continue natural gas aggregation program beyond September 2016 when current supply agreement ends.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we adopt Resolution 89-2016. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Cerisi seconds. Okay, this is the gas aggregation program. This is to continue the current natural gas aggregation program through this year.
Sam, is an emergency.
We need
to make a motion.
Oh, did we need an emergency on this?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You want to make that motion?
Make a motion to
just adopt it as an emergency. It's a resolution.
Right, but you have to adopt. You have to amend it to be an emergency before you can adopt.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm going to. So, right, Dave?
Yeah, it doesn't have it in there, so you have to adopt the standard emergency.
Okay, so I make a motion that we add a standard emergency clause to Resolution 89-2016.
Okay. Is there a second on this motion?
I'll second.
Mr. Cerisi did. Any questions there? We don't understand why we need it. Shannon, call the roll on the emergency, on the reason.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Okay, now we need to go back to my motion. I will rephrase that as adoption of Resolution 89-2016 as an emergency.
A second.
I think we had a second, right? Mr. Cerisi, second. Call the roll.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Okay, Resolution 89-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Next we have Ordinance 90-2016.
An ordinance amending the current year appropriations for the various general and special revenue accounts as established in Ordinance 6-2016, the appropriation ordinance of the City of Twinsburg for the year 2016 and declaring an emergency.
Okay, I will make a motion that we suspend the rules on Ordinance 90-2016, place it on its third and final reading, and declare it an emergency. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Roden seconds. Any discussion on that? Shannon, call the roll.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Okay, now I need a motion to adopt Ordinance 90-2016 as an emergency. Who wants to make that motion?
I'll make that motion.
Mr. Roden, is there a second?
I'll second.
Ms. McFerrin, any discussion on this one? We're amending the operating fund for the Twinsburg Fitness Center by $6,900 to include the amount of $18,100 to purchase the equipment from Witch, which is the former restaurant in the Twinsburg Fitness Center.
Yeah, this is has been negotiated about 20 cents on the dollar of what the equipment's was purchased for less than a year ago. This has allowed the city to operate a cafe, whatever you want to call it, out of the Witch facility. So.
Okay, Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes. Okay, Ordinance 90-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. We have Ordinance 91-2016.
An ordinance amending the current year appropriations for the various general and special revenue accounts as established in Ordinance 6-2016, the appropriation ordinance of the City of Twinsburg for the year 2016, and declaring an emergency.
I'd like to make a motion that we suspend the rules on Ordinance 91-2016, place it on its third and final reading, and declare it an emergency. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Ms. McFerrin seconds. Any discussion? Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Okay, now I need a motion to adopt Ordinance 91-2016 as an emergency.
So moved.
Mr. Cerisi, is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Steele, discussion?
Again, this is the purchase of, or to go ahead and allow us to contract with a printing company to for the bicentennial book that's going to come out next year that'll be available to both the residents or all the residents of the Reminderville, the township, and Twinsburg. We've all been working collectively over the last year planning the events and everything that's going on with this particular bicentennial year that we're going to have, and this is going to be a nice coffee table book that should be welcome to all the residents.
Okay, Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Okay, Ordinance 91-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Ordinance 92-2016.
An ordinance approving a change order to the contract with Environmental Management Specialists Incorporated for the modification of additional work related to the underground storage tank removal project and declaring an emergency.
Make a motion that we suspend the rules on Ordinance 92-2016, place it on its third and final reading, and declare it an emergency. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Cerisi seconds. Discussion? This work has already been done, and this is to pay the contractor for the changes that occurred due to delays in the project. Okay. Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Okay, now I need a motion to adopt Ordinance 92-2016 as an emergency. Is there a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Mrs. Stauffer, is there a second?
I'll second.
Ms. McFerrin, discussion?
This is simply the $9,000 that we needed to complete the removal of the gas tank by the fire station.
Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Okay, Ordinance 92-2016 passes 7-0 as an emergency. Ordinance 93-2016.
An ordinance amending the current year appropriations for the various general and special revenue accounts as established in Ordinance 6-2016, the appropriation ordinance of the City of Twinsburg for the year 2016.
Okay, and that stands on its first reading. Resolution 94-2016.
A resolution confirming the current members of the Civil Service Commission and establishing the terms of office of each member.
Okay, I need a motion to adopt Resolution 94-2016. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Mr. Cerisi, is there a second?
I'll second.
Mr. Roden. Discussion? Shannon, call the roll, please.
Mr. Cerisi?
Yes.
Mr. Roden?
Yes.
Mr. Fury?
Yes.
Mr. Scafidi?
Yes.
Mr. Steele?
Yes.
Ms. McFerrin?
Yes.
Mrs. Stauffer?
Yes.
Okay, resolution 94-2016 passes 7-0. Next, we will move on to unfinished business, new business, and miscellaneous. Shannon, we'll start with you. Do you have anything tonight? No. Okay. Mr. Fury, do you?
Just want to compliment you on what an efficient meeting you ran this evening.
You mean this is only the first time? I've been doing this for almost a year now. This is my first efficient meeting.
You're supposed to just smile and say thank you.
Yeah. I have questions.
It wasn't a therapy session. It was just a compliment.
I appreciate it. Thanks. That's it?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Ceresi.
I wanted to thank the members of the CERT team who weren't official in their capacity but volunteered to help us park cars last week at the football game. It was a last-minute decision to allow cars to park on the front lawn of Chamberlain, and so they needed people to steer them around. They were there unofficially, not as their CERT team, but they knew the routine because they've done it so much and well-trained and so forth. So just wanted to thank them for volunteering and helping out the schools and the athletic department. That's all. Thanks.
Thank you. Ms. McFerrin.
I just want to thank all the department heads for their great job they're doing.
Okay. Thank you. All I have is to announce the next council caucus will start at 7 o'clock on September 27th, and the council meeting will follow at 7:30. That's all I have this evening. Thank you.
Mr. Rogan. I have no one to thank this evening, but I have nothing.
Okay. Mr. Steele.
I just want to say with everything that happened over off of East Idlewood, I am so glad that none of the people that I worked with was hurt. I know those guys that were there, and I know they did the job that they were supposed to do. And on a lighter note, that was the calmest I've ever seen Yasso. Anytime I've ever been around that dog when he was getting his puppuccino.
Okay, thank you. Mrs. Stockton.
I have nothing.
Mary Yates.
Just quickly, if you've stayed in tune with what's going on with the medical marijuana that's going on here in the state of Ohio, and if you've watched a little bit of what communities are doing in passing legislation on a moratorium to prevent the growing of that within the city limits. I would ask council to consider that. I'm going to suggest that we prepare legislation for our next meeting. Every day there's more municipalities that are passing this moratorium, and I don't want to be the last one left standing, and they all come here to set up growth. So I would ask council to think about that, and there will be legislation in the next meeting, and we can talk about it then at that time. But I just wanted to prepare you. That's all I have.
I think it's a great idea. Thank you. Mr. Maestros, anything?
Nothing, thank you.
Okay. Hearing nothing, I guess that's it. We will now adjourn the meeting. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Absolutely.